matter what it feels like, no matter what it seems like, God is always, always worthy of all the prayers. Yes, He is. Yes, He is. Praise the name of the Lord. Clap your hands one time for the Lord. Just usher in His goodness and His glory. Thank you, Jesus. Bless His name. Bless His name. While you're still standing, let's turn in our Bibles to the book of Genesis, chapter 14. Genesis chapter 14. Praise the Lord. Genesis 14. Let's look at verse 21 and 22. And then we'll drop to chapter 15, verse 1. Genesis 14, 21 and 22. When you have it, say amen. And the king of Sodom said unto Abram, give me the persons and take the goods to thyself. And Abram said to the king of Sodom, I have lifted up mine hand unto the Lord, the Most High, the possessor of heaven and earth. Chapter 15, verse 1. After these things, the word of the Lord came unto Abram in a vision, saying, fear not, Abram, I am thy shield and thy exceeding great reward. You may be seated. I just want to speak to you for a little while this morning about what it is to lean fully on the Lord. What it is to lean fully on the Lord. We find in Genesis 14 that Abram is just coming back from war. We find that the people of God are in a place where they are scattered. And they are scattered living among enemies. And in particular, we find that there are four kings that take Lot, Abram's nephew, for hostage. Yes, they do. And not only do they take Lot, but they take Lot, his wives, and all of his possessions. See, when the enemy actually wants a child of God, a person who is promised of God, who God has his hands on, and not just wants to use, but also wants to bless. The enemy knows that. And often before we know it, see, a lot of us know that God wants to use us, but we don't even accept in our person, accept in our spirits, accept that God also wants to bless us, that who he uses, he also wants to bless. So many times we get afraid to actually do anything for God, go anywhere for God, go the extra mile for the Lord, because we know that God has a use for us. And the use scares us because we think that God is going to use us, and in being used, we are afraid that we'll be used up. But God wants to not just use us, but he wants to bless us too. I hope somebody is listening. That we don't have to fear being used of God, knowing that God also wants to bless us. And in being blessed, our use is also ordained by God. It is consummated by God in what is called a covenant. That God doesn't just want to use you, but in blessing you, he makes promises unto you to keep you in all of your ways. That no matter what your enemies do, or say or try to convince you of, because you are also blessed of God in being used by God, the enemy can't touch you. So Abram understands that God has a use for him. And the use that God has for him is to leave and to go out into the world, into a land that God has promised him. But in doing so, there are enemies, the Bible said, that come up against Abram. And they decide to plot on Abram, on what is in Abram's camp. Isn't it something how the enemy has a way of when he wants to get at you, and he knows you are a child of promise, that you are used of God, and that God has a blessing for you, that his best way of getting at you is to mess with people who are connected to you. People who are connected to you are often a target of the enemy, because the enemy knows that if he were to do a full front attack on you, there's something that's prayed up about you that has seen that before, you've been there before, and that trick won't work with you. But if he could only mess with your children, your spouses, the people who are connected to you, the folks who are actually supposed to have your vision and your spirit, what the enemy is trying to do is test your connections to see if the people who are around you and connected to you have enough spirit about you and understand that if God has called you, he's also called them. That if God will bless you, he also will bless them. The enemy's trying to see if there's a weakness in the understanding of those who are connected to you of just what God wants to do, not just for you, but for them through you. He tests the connection. And in the case of Abram, he steals away the man who is called Abram's minister, Abram's nephew, the one who was supposed to be his connection, his right hand. See if he could actually pull the two apart and get Abram away from the promise that God had for him. So Abram decides that he can't do the thing that God would have for him to do without those who God has blessed in his life, those who God has also called in his life, those who are to be workers in his dream, those who are actually supposed to love the dream and supposed to work it and mold it and minister to the minister as they move along through what God has for them in their future. Something how, as we move forward for God, sometimes we forget that God has sent people to us to be our blessing. And we'll be so quick to think that what God has shown us, that we're the only ones who are supposed to see it. And yes, God gives to the visionary first, but it's important that we share, because God does not make each and every one of us islands unto ourselves. He's given those capacity to be a blessing to us as we are a blessing to others. So Abram knows that whatever God has for him, he trusts that he can't do it alone. So he has to go and rescue his nephew. He has to send for the one who God has given him as a friend. He can't allow himself to go forward in life and lead those who are also anointed to make God's promise come true. So he knows that it is possible to do for God. He knows it's possible to run for God. It's possible to minister for God. But oftentimes we'll settle without a foot or an arm, without an appendage that God has given us, and we'll minister and mush and move through life with a handicap, with a type of disability, and we'll settle for that disability over going back and taking the time and the boldness of working with those who God has given us as arms and legs, as eyes and ears, as mouthpieces. God has given us people in the kingdom that are useful to his ministry. If we'll only take the time to rescue them from their circumstances and understand their capacity and what God has blessed them with for the future. Lot. No, Lot wasn't the visionary. No, Lot could not see what God gave Abram to see, but he was nonetheless useful to the purpose of God in Abram's life. We have to be careful, the people we leave by the wayside, that God is saying they have yet a use for me. And the use that they have for the kingdom has to come through you. Who has God assigned in your life for the ministry? Who has God given unto you to say the two of you, the three of you, the family that you are, nobody's actually going to reach the furthest and is actually going to have the deepest in life unless you go together. Yep. Unless you find reason to support and encourage one another. Isn't it something that when two or three gather, God promised to be in the midst of it? And the interesting thing is God promises to be in the midst, which means that whatever is being said, whatever is being done, whatever is actually being given as a praise, whatever is being said as a report, God is saying, I'll be in the middle of it. I'll be right there. Although it's not fully formed, although the thoughts aren't actually being communicated, actually the future is not fully seen, the idea has not taken fruition yet, but because the two of you have gathered, you've decided to elect that we are of God's elect. You decided to say, God, here we are, send us. Because you are with one accord and you are in agreement, God says, I will be in the agreement even before the thing is actually funded, before the thing actually has all of its legs under it. Before it all, the foundation of it is that I am in the middle of your agreement. Agreement. So Abram decides to go into Dan, which is a city that is close to Damascus. It's in the northern part of Israel, where the enemies, the four kings, lie captured and have captured Lot. So the Bible says that Abram assembled his men, and not just any men. He says that he had men who were armed and trained servants. Armed and trained servants. The interesting thing about Abram sending his armed and trained servants means that Abram had some servants who weren't armed and trained for war. The servants he had that were not armed and trained for war had to stay home on their posts. That there were some servants that Abram had that could cook. There's some that could clean, some that knew how to deal with the stable and the horses. There were some servants that he had that knew how to deal with sheep. But he only picked those servants that were armed and who were trained, meaning that not all people can actually help you and are trained to go and get back what God has given unto you to retrieve. So that a lot of us will actually have children and relatives and friends who are out captured by the world. And God is saying, you don't have the right specialists. You don't have the right people. You haven't commissioned the right individuals that actually have the expertise to help you and your children and your family and your friends in the areas that they are suffering with. That's why a lot of us will ignore what's needed through therapy, what is needed in terms of counselors, what's needed in terms of specialists, and we'll just say, I'll put it in God's hands. But what we're not understanding is God also anointed the nurse, and the doctor, and the therapist, and the counselor, and the pastoral counselor to actually help in areas of your family's life to help retrieve those who God has assigned to you who are useful to the ministry of God. It's something how we'll send the wrong servants. God is saying, send your armed and trained servants to retrieve those who I love, who are in your life and profitable for ministry. Send the armed ones and the trained ones. A lot of us don't even understand the things that our children suffer with, because a lot of it is not actually their thing. It comes actually from us. It's a generational curse that they're dealing with, that they're not old enough, not mature enough, and not wise enough, and also not spiritual enough to understand. so that our perspective is, what's wrong with my child? All I know is that they're acting up in class all the time, and that they're always locked away in their room, and that they listen to music that I don't approve of. But what we don't understand is that these are only just symptoms of something deeper that they are captured by, that the enemy has on the outskirts of Israel. Somewhere on the outskirts, they have been influenced and captured away from the kingdom of God. And we have to learn how to send our arm and our trend to help us go retrieve. Our arm and our trend. We are, in the African American community, less likely to receive medical help, and the least likely to receive psychological and emotional help. And we have to be careful. We have to be careful that most problems that we have, that we deal with, they come either from we're inherited issues through genetics or environment, that our kids, our family members will pick up on stuff. And you'll be surprised what an image through a cell phone, a song, a drug, just being secondhand contact with the drug, will transfer into a child, that they will suffer with the meaning and the understanding of it, and there'll be parts of their lives that they will grow abnormal and not healthy in, because they're suffering with an image that now becomes a spirit, and they don't understand how to actually let it flee from their life. So yes, they can sit in church for 2 and 3 services. Yes, they can do their homework and go to school on time, but what if there's something deeper that's under the surface that actually snatched their attention while you are not listening and looking and observing? It's time to grab our children and our community back, those that are profitable to us. And we don't understand why it's always the faithful few. And we almost, at times, carry it as a badge of honor. Oh, I'm one of the faithful few, and the rest have fallen by the wayside. God is saying it's time to go and retrieve Lot. Time to go get him back. That for all that the faithful few can do, imagine what we can all do when we go back to a place where we help heal those who God has also promised. Lot goes with his armed and trained men. The Bible says he overtook them. And in his triumphant return, the king of Sodom, where Abram and Lot dwell, the king of Sodom says something interesting. He went out to meet him, the Bible says, after his return from the slaughter, and of the king that were with him at the valley of Sheba, which is the king's dale. The Bible says that Melchizedek, the king of Salem, blessed Abram. This what's interesting, that Abram, rather than to reside in the king of his home's court and get full praise from his king's court, he rather be blessed in God's court. That the blessing in God's court doesn't look the same as the blessing in his home court. That in his home court comes a certain type of recognition, a certain title, and a certain earthly promise. That in God's court, folks can say, all that is a bunch of incense and talk, but where's the real reward, Abram? Doesn't look like Melchizedek has given you much. Doesn't feel like you're actually getting a real king's reward. Why did Abram say that I'd rather have the blessing of the Lord than to have the reward of those who that might know me, that might see me, that might understand me, but yet don't understand what God's promises to me. Abram decides that what's more important than the spoils of war, than the things that people can give you, the praise, the outward appearance of holiness, is the inward promises that God has in store, the things that eyes have not seen and that ears have not heard, that God has laid up and that are in store for those who love him and diligently seek after righteousness. It's so important that the way that we grab back and snatch back what God has given us, that we understand that it's not for the world's eyes to see. It's not to have a testimony of what you did. It's not to have a testimony of how great a parent you are. Because the most important thing that can result from you reconnecting and you creating a new understanding of your role and the role of those connected to you, the greater thing that God has set aside is that there can be ministry that goes forward, that we actually stop pointing at what we did and the journey to go backwards, and that we actually go forward sometime in life. Isn't it something how our testimony is often built on getting back stuff? God is saying that's just the starting point. That's just to get you to ground zero. It's now about what are you going to do? You see, Abram had enough wisdom to know that the greatest stuff I could get back, the greatest thing I could ever get back, were the people that God gave me as connections. That the reward, the money and the gold is not actually profitable to God's ministry first. That will come. The more important thing is the soul. Because this is something that God can do when he puts two and three together. Is something that God can do when he puts those who have him first together. There is something great that God actually wants to transfer to the world. But what it takes before it takes money and substance, it takes willing souls. Takes souls. Abram knew, I don't want the king's reward. I'd rather be blessed. I'd rather God bless me. And blessing is a permission. It's a permission to say that wherever I go in the name of God, whatever I do in God's name, as long as it's in the will of God, that there'll be no harm to come near me, that I dwell then in the secret place of the Most High. That a blessing is a permission to dwell where nobody can harm you, where the things of the world have actually no dominion over you. You are actually dwelling in a promise. That a promise is like the shadow, the Bible says in Psalms 90. It's like the shadow of God's wing. That's what a promise is. It's a promise to say, as long as you stay here in my will, that no matter what you do and put your hands to, it will actually prosper. That's what a blessing is. That a blessing, it is blessed that when God actually calls you his child, you actually have permission to go in the world and to live according to God's standard, that no matter what happens to you, you have a greater purpose that supersedes the fear and the emotions that come with the rest of the world, that if they did the same thing, they would have to suffer the repercussions. That those who are called by God according to his purpose don't have to fear what the world says or tries to do to discourage you. You are blessed.
Thank
you, Lord. Blessed. The Bible says in the 15th chapter, verse 1, after these things, after Abram decided that he knew he couldn't do half of what he was meant and promised to do without Lot, and retrieved him, and was blessed of the man of God, over the man of the people. The Bible says, Abram says, after these things, the word of the Lord came to him in a vision, saying, fear not, Abram, I am thy shield and thy exceeding great reward. Shield and thy exceeding great reward. That if you hide behind my promise, in my covenant, that if you keep covenant with me, that it will shield you, that my will actually protect you, that the safest place, Christians, we can ever be is in the will of God. It's the safest place. Not trusting substance and things and ways and formulas and strategies above the will of God. That the will of God has a way of protecting you from the things that the enemy would like to harm you and take you captive with. That it has a way of keeping you from, as the Bible says, the fowler's snare. Fowler's snare. Keeping you from the pit, the traps that the enemy has set for those who forsake wisdom for folly. Those who would rather be anxious than patient. The will of God, having the characteristics of God, in other words, being obedient to how God would actually have you live and act and talk and think and connect and communicate, is the safest place you could ever be. And in doing so, we are shielded. That Abram is promised of God through a vision. You are shielded. In other words, as long as you stay with me, don't worry. Don't worry about all of the things, big and small, intricate political things, community stuff, all of the interest, I will send people to help work it out. Just stay in my will. Stay with my will. We find ourselves praying for so much stuff, wishing and hoping for things. And the greatest thing we could ever do is pray for ourselves and the people who God has use for. That God will change people. And it's our job to change things. That we'll pray so much for things. God is saying, change your spirit. Change your attitude. Change your outlook. Change your emotions. Change your vision. Become the thing that God wants us to be in his will. Obedient children who will follow after his way. Lastly, and I'll take my seat, that in being shielded by God, being in the will of God, he also promised Abram that I have the exceeding great reward. In other words, I have a cup for you, and that cup will run over with blessing. The thing that I have for you is so much, there is so much reward for being faithful that it will overflow. It'll overflow. And the great thing about God's overflow is it doesn't matter if you are Abram, who he actually promised it to, or you are Lot, that because being connected to the promise, you are being blessed. There is an overflow, that the overflow allows you to touch yet the hem of Jesus's garment, that you are able to be blessed simply because you are connected. And most of us won't actually have the vision that God has given. We won't actually be the ones who are given the vision like Abram was, but we are yet connected. And it is important that we trust the connection to the vision. that as long as we are connected to the vision and we don't despise the vision and we work in the vision and we are believers and we are cooperative and we are trusting one to another, just being connected qualifies me for the overflow. That the exceeding blessing, the exceeding great reward will trickle down to those who are just connected to the vision. It's important that we understand that God has an exceeding blessing that starts with us being in the will of God. Starts with the will of God. And no matter what he promises, we are disqualified if we don't have him as our shield. We are exposed. And everybody connected to us is exposed. Exposed. And we have to deal and be honest with ourselves about how exposed we leave those who are connected to us. That we may love and enjoy and wish for our families. We may pray for them, but because of our disobedience, they are exposed. They're exposed. They're exposed to things that they don't even understand and might not even want, but are yet exposed. Unless we are shielded in the will of God. And I know we want so much. We want to see our children graduate. We want to see our families healed. We want to get out of debt. My grandmother, the one thing she always wanted, and I remember going to see her on her deathbed, and the one thing she always wanted, she said, was for her family to be whole. That's the one thing. She didn't want in the end for money or fame. She wanted her family to be whole. And it's something how she left here with a hope and a desire for something she had no time to change. No time. And then she and my grandfather were part of a generation that had the ability and the capacity and the know-how to do something about it. But we only have windows, saints. We only have windows of influence. Abram only had a small window to get Lot back. So he had to choose wisely who went with him. And he definitely had to know that he was chosen by God. Don't go back to retrieve something or someone God has not assigned to you. You only have a window. Reaching back is only a small window. It's so interesting how God sent his only begotten son through a window of time. Only a window. Only 30 some odd years. And most of it was growing, learning, communicating, and connecting. His ministry was only a few years. And in that time, he had a small window to reach back and actually take the keys to hell in his hands and take the kingdom and the space that we occupy with him through our connection to him and declare to a world, present and future, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have everlasting life through connection, just through a window. The whole world had access to everlasting life as long as we declare to be in the will of God, that whoever, Jew and Gentile, will have through ages that he hadn't been in yet, through time that hadn't come yet, in a future that no one sees yet, will have access to life and life more abundantly through belief, through connection, through obedience to God. God is saying there's an exceeding great reward. Stand on your feet. To those who would be shielded, who would be shielded, those who would allow themselves to dwell in the secret place of the Most High. God has some curse breakers in this room. Folks who God has called to seal the breach, to stand in the gap. God has created you to be the miracle that you've been waiting for in your family and in your connections. And there is yet a window open. Don't waste your window. Don't let your kids become 20 and 25 and 30. There's a window to reach back. It may not feel like they're listening and that they're watching you. It may not seem like they care, but they hear you. They see it. You're still there as long as you put God in the middle of it, in the midst. As long as He's in the middle of it, there is yet still hope. I know they look like they wear their clothes on backwards. I know it just looks hopeless. Seems like young folks don't have any respect for the church, let alone you and I. But there is yet hope. Trust in the Lord. Seek Him first. All of His righteousness. All the things that you want, God is going to add them to you. He's going to make your life greater than it's ever been. Let's look to the Lord.